Who could write such a twisted, crazy book? So, yeah.
Get her!
Master Ninja theme song!
So the movie is coming out. And it's out, I guess. It's out.
Yeah, it is. It is. It's out.
And where was the very first premiere? Where was the first
The world premiere was down in Texas at South by Southwest Film Festival, and I did go to that, and it was so exciting. I mean, it was like every author's dream come true. At these movie theaters, they actually serve food. So like you can order food and drinks and be watching the film. And so like my favorite food in the entire world is cheesecake. And so I was like sitting there watching my book made into a movie on the big screen while eating cheesecake. And I was just like, I remember stopping and being like, you know, this is author heaven. I mean, this is it. Like I've died and gone to author heaven.
Does the film, does it get the KL going seal of approval?
It absolutely does. Yeah, it absolutely does. And it was funny because the third showing down in Texas, I went to each showing. The third showing, I ended up deciding to give up my seats so some people could go in because there was just a huge line and like people were getting turned away. And I had already seen it at that point three times, even though that's never enough for me. I feel like I could see it a million times, but I wanted other people to get the experience of going in. So my husband and myself and some friends that we were with, we let other people go in. But anyway, I was standing out ahead of time and talking to people in line and handing out bumper stickers and pins. And I met these guys that were sitting there and, you know, they turned out to be film buyers. And, you know, and so they were waiting in line to get in. And they said, you know, well, what's your connection to the movie? And I kind of sheepishly said, well, you know, I'm the author of the book. And they were shocked and they were like, oh my gosh, they said it's so rare for the author not to be cynical about the movie version of their book. And, you know, and I said, like, I'm not cynical about it at all. I feel like they did a wonderful job capturing the heart of the film. They stayed really close to the book. Everything that I wanted to be in there, you know, is in there. And, I feel like they did a beautiful job and it's a beautiful film in its own right too. You know, I didn't feel like they had to capture word by word, you know, Fat Kid Rules the World. I felt like I wanted that emotion that I talked about earlier, you know, that I needed in there in the heart, and they got that.
And Matthew Lillard is the director, and did he speak to you before he made the film? Did you guys talk about what he planned to do?
This has been just a long journey. I don't know if you've read too much of the background stuff, but Matt actually optioned the book 9 years ago, and he read the audiobook version, and we had sent – Listening Library did the audiobook, and they sent it to Will Ferrell as a potential reader, and he passed, but Will Ferrell's manager suggested that it might be the perfect book for Matt. And so she gave it to Matt, and he made the decision to do it, but he hadn't even read the book. And then he said he was in the recording studio, and about 20 pages in, there were just tears running down his cheeks, and he just felt like, you know, this is me, this was me, you know, and he really felt like he was saved as a kid, you know, by acting, and that, you know, but he related to the punk rock aspect of it, and just had this really intense personal kind of epiphany about the book. So he optioned film rights at that point, and we talked on the phone, and I met his manager who came to New York, and, you know, and really nice. And I remember like Matt calling the first time, and he said he was really nervous to talk to me, which I thought was hysterical. Cause it's like, it's the other way around. I'm nervous to talk to you. Like, but anyway, so he talked to me, and he was just really passionate about the film and what he could do with it. And we did have other interest at the time from another studio. And so, you know, there was a real decision to be made, but I just felt like I knew in my gut that Matt was the right person to do it and that he got the story at the level that I needed somebody to get it at. And so Matt fought for, you know, years to make this film and just got a zillion no's all around Hollywood. And everybody was like, you know, you can't make a movie with a fat kid in the lead without it being a comedy, basically, you know, which is sad because, you know, it's so not true. And we knew that wasn't true. But how do you convince people that, you know, audiences will go see a movie where Fat Kid isn't just the joke. And there is a lot of humor in Fat Kid Rules the World, but there's also a lot of drama too. And the character of Troy, I think in the book and in the film, if we've done our jobs, is really multifaceted. And I don't feel like, you know, I don't feel like you can't have any humor, but he's not the joke.
I think you really, it's the book is a slice of life. I mean, I think that's what you want in a book too, Life is funny and heartbreaking and difficult, and you captured all of that.
Thank you.
You're welcome. And I cannot wait to see it on film.
At that point, when that came back in, they started to work together. And that was when Rick Rosenthal and Whitewater Films got involved. And now all of a sudden there was the synergy to do this as an independent film, which I think is perfect for Fat Kid because it has that spirit and that vibe. And, you know, and punk rock is, you know, DIY type of stuff anyway. So, yeah, so that's when they came in. But he's really been fighting to get the film out there for a long time, and I give him a ton of credit for that.
What he has accomplished is going to go down in history, I think, for a new way for independent film to really...
I hope so, and he's out there now, I mean, still promoting it, which, you know, he's out on the Vans Warped Tour, and he has a family, he's got a wife and three kids, and, you know, and yet he's out there schlepping around, you know, doing the Vans Warped Tour, you know, type of thing, and I know that there's not a lot of people who would have done that, and if... a lot of people, you know, like if they had even fought that hard to get the film made in the first place, once it was made, I think they would have accepted any deal that was offered, you know. And yet all along for Matt, for Whitewater Films, for Whippany Park Productions, everybody has wanted the best for this film and the best for this book. And we want it to get out there. I mean, we could have made a deal where it would have gone right to DVD obscurity. And then whoever happened to trip upon it would trip upon it, you know. But that's not what we've wanted. We've known all along that there is a demographic out there that this book was written for and that the film was made for. And if we can reach those people and inspire those people, we know that it's going to touch lives. It's going to change lives. And everybody involved, you know, just has complete belief in the film. And I think that's really pretty amazing in this world that we live in, you know, and the kind of, I don't know, the stories you hear about cynical Hollywood and, you know, and all this kind of stuff, but this is not that story. I mean, this is a story where every single person has foregone money and, you know, and given their time and literally, you know, like just, I mean, I drop everything as soon as, if somebody like you says, you know what, I'm going to get the film in a theater and I'm going to spend the time to promote it. I'm like, you know what, you want to interview me? I'll drop everything that I'm doing because this is important to me. And everybody cares that passionately, which is really cool. I couldn't ask for more.
You know, maybe Mr. Robot will want a southern accent.
Well, I'm off. I got things to do.
All right. Hello, everyone. Sorry. Oh, hello, Gypsy. Hi. You look splendid today. Mr. Kevin Bacon. Lovely to work with you again. Lovely, beautiful. Well. What are we doing? Judy, what are we doing?
We are shooting the film today, Mr. Robot, and we're all set.
And the camera?
Right where it always is, Mr. Robot. Right over there.
None of your lip, Judy.
Thank you.
Ah, Kenbot. Wonderful. Let's see if we can't squeeze a little of your magic onto 35mm. N'est-ce pas?
Bro, hey, can we get going? Because, you know, we got to get
going. Of course. Judy, what am I doing?
Still shooting the first scene, Mr. Robot.
Excellent. And action!
Roll sound.
Roll sound!
Speed!
Camera. I know. Camera!
Rolling!
Marker!
101A, take one.
And...
Crow?
God damn it! What is your problem, Kevin?
Well, you're right in the shot. I'm sorry.
No. Ah, so I am. And suddenly you've become the director. Well, I guess we can't shoot today. Mr. Bacon isn't very happy. Well, just so happens that Cassavetes was in plenty of his own films. And so is Stallone, Coleman Francis, Hal Needham, all the greats.
I just didn't think you wanted to be smack dab.
Very good. Judy, what am I doing?
We're doing another take, Mr. Robot.
Excellent. And this time I choose not to be in the scene. Okay, and action!
Roll sound.
Roll sound.
Speed.
Camera. I know. Camera.
Rolling.
Marker.
101A, take two.
And action.
Why, sweet Marie, you know, I got a hang...
Print! That's a wrap, everyone! Beautiful work. Thank you so much. It's been a wonderful time.
Wait, that's it? That's all?
I didn't get to say beans! Well, we'll loop the lines in ADR. The rest is second unit stuff. Thank you, everyone. I'm off. Bye!
Or dope spent the whole $800 on the scarf.
Oh, we got movie silence. Hey. We got movie silence.
And I just think that you have inspired this humanity in people to like come up and say, this is a story that needs to be told. This is a story that needs to be shared.
I've had this dream all along of like, it's just, this is the corniest dream. I can't even get it. You know, I can't even believe I'm going to tell you this, but like, I've had this vision ever since I wrote the book of like, just this, like everybody standing up and saying, I am the fat kid. You know, like that's what I want everybody. Like I want like, you know, public service ads where all the celebrities who are gorgeous stand up and say it. And I'm just like, that's what I want. I want this mass movement of people standing up no matter what they look like and just saying, I am the fat kid, you know, like I relate to this. And that's what the movie is about. And I think in the best world, that's what it's inspiring, hopefully.
We are the world. We are the fat kid.
We are the ones who make a brighter day. So let's start giving.
I'm so excited about the movie, and that's why I'm doing the tug thing. And how many do you have now?
You know, I know Matt had said that he talked to them at one point and said, well, what would be kind of like, what would be a success? You know, and they had said maybe 500 requests overall in the course of the life of the film. And in 1 week, we got more than 700. And I don't know how many we're at now, but I hope that it is continuing. And, you know, and there's a lot of them up on the tugofthefatkid.com is our personal tug site. And, you know, you can go there and there's a lot of them coming up, new ones all the time. And it's great. It's so fun to see. I check it all the time. I'm like, this is how I was with Kickstarter. I would check it religiously, you know, and now I check tug.com and I see like which ones are confirmed and who's sold enough tickets and, you know, who's still out there. And it's just, he's promoting it. It's wonderful.
It is.
It's really exciting.
It's a great way to really like, I mean, people haven't even seen it yet.
Yeah.
That's the amazing thing.
Yeah, it is. It's pretty amazing.
So it's your book. Your book is the thing that is like, people want to see your vision on the screen. Yeah. They want to see it brought to life. And Jacob Wysocki looks amazing.
He is. He's so good. Oh my gosh. The whole cast is so good. You're going to love them. I mean, you can't help falling in love with them. Jacob Wysocki as Troy is amazing.
I can't go. No way. Because there's no way I can be around normal people.
This is too sad.
I mean, what happens if I'm too big to fit in the car? Or
Troy,
they give me enough room in the car, and then everybody's running.
Troy.
Hey, who invited the
Troy?
Matt O'Leary as Marcus is just, he's captivating. He's so energetic.
Why do we have to break into your house if you live here?
Because it's my mom's house, and I lost my keys. See, I had them, and then all of a sudden the sink, and then I lost it. God, I'm in. Okay, get my stuff and then meet me at the front door.
Billy Campbell as the dad he's perfect as the dad.
You understand the concept of responsibility, Marcus, because you have a responsibility here. I'm putting my trust in you. Is that a mistake?
Dylan Arnold plays Dale. He's wonderful. Lily Simmons is Isabel, and she's like gorgeous and yet remains punk rock. And they did such a good job. And I love Jacob. He is able to just convey so much emotion that he has to go from, you know, comedy to drama throughout the course of the film, back and forth. And he does it wonderfully. I really want to hear feedback from people who see the film. So please, you know, like when you have your screening and you have a chance to see it, you know, please let me know. What do you think of the film? I'm so curious to hear what other people think. I love it personally, but I want to know, you know, do other people feel like, you know, the same way that I do about it? I think that it just really resonates. That one of the last screening that we had at South by Southwest, was like just the most perfect audience reaction, where like during the Q&A time afterwards, you know, at the film festivals, they do the Q&A. And I mean, people like literally stood up and were like, you know, this is an amazing fucking film, you know, and like you just don't get that usually. You get, you know, like you get the questions asked and people kind of, you know, like one guy stood up and he was like, you know, that's me on the screen. And another person, you know, was saying that, you know, they just felt like the movie was going to change lives. And those are the kinds of reactions that you don't get to every film, you know, and that's the kind of thing that really has kept us going in taking huge risks. And, you know, Kickstarter was a huge risk. And I think all of us, you know, at a certain point, I mean, I've said to Matt, literally, I've said to him several times, like, you're insane. You know, that like, and I said to him one time, I was like, I am so glad I am not in charge of this and making these decisions, because I would never have the guts to do it. But he does. He, you know, and he said to me that his response was, I am so glad I am. And I'm so glad he is too, because he is willing to do these things and put himself on the line. And Kickstarter was just amazing, because when they said we were going to try and raise $150,000 in 40 days, I was like, this is crazy. And I kept thinking, like, couldn't you just lower it? Like, how about 50? 50 would be plenty, you know what I mean? But they knew what we needed. They knew what we needed to get out there and promote the film, to be able to send it on the Vans Warped Tour, and to be able to do the kind of promotion that we need with Tug. And, you know, and they were willing to say, let's just throw it out to the universe and people catch us. And they did.
Yeah, and Kickstarter's all or nothing. So, you know, you guys could have raised like $75,000 and lost it all on The Price is Right.
Yeah, I know. It was totally scary. I was like, at certain points during the Kickstarter 40-day run, I literally thought, like, I can't do this. I'm just like, I'm too tense all the time. I check it every hour, you know. I had to just restrain myself. So, yeah. But it was really fun though. And it's such a feel good moment that, like, you know, when people really started just getting on board and people, and so many of those donations were $5 and $1. We didn't get, like, I don't think we got any of the really big number donations, which in the beginning, you know, you think, well, maybe that's how we'll do it. You know, maybe we'll get some corporation who's willing to, you know, to spend $10,000 to get Matt to go out and be their puppet for a day. You know, it's like, but that's not what happened. Instead, it was just
McDonald's would sponsor Fat Kid Rules the World.
I know, right? That would be perfect.
It would be perfect, but man, I think they'd stay away.
Yeah, I think so too. Yeah. But anyway, it was, you know, but that wasn't how it happened. It was just a lot of people giving $1 and giving $5 and giving $10 and $25. And, you know, and how much better is that? How much cooler is that, that we made our goal with that kind of.
And that's your audience right there. And, you know, if they're going to pay up front just to have the ability to possibly see it.
I know.
When it comes to their city, they're going to shell it out and come to see this awesome fucking film.
Yes, exactly.
So I can't. And on behalf of all your fans and everyone that has supported this project and, you know, been involved with it at any stage in this project, thank you for creating this story and these people and these situations that make our lives seem a little more relevant to the rest of the world, you know?
That's awesome. Thank you.
You're welcome.
Thank you.
So,
I just want to say thank you, because I'm very much aware of the fact that this is a book that is for the people, and it's, you know, it is just, none of this would be happening without people like you who are out there reading the book, supporting the book, you know, and now supporting the film. I mean, it just wouldn't be happening without that, you know? So it's like, I feel like in a lot of ways, I mean, I took my risk early on to, you know, to put myself out there and to put the story out there, you know, and to say, I'm trusting that the world doesn't just totally reject me and kick my ass, you know, type of thing. That was my risk early on. And people haven't. People have been awesome. And I, you know, feel like I want everybody to experience that, you know, and I'm so grateful to all the readers out there and all the people who are putting this together and who are making it happen. And, you know, and I want everybody, I hope that everybody feels like a part of the movement, because those of us who are at the center of the movement, you know, like we feel that energy and the excitement and like just the incredibleness of it in a really intense way. And I know that, you know, like that's what I want everybody to be able to feel. And I hope that the screenings will do that. You know, I hope that there's that same kind of energy and excitement at the screenings and that, you know, everybody who views this has an amazing time.
There's an incredible surge of energy in this project. And yeah. I think that it all came from your spark. So,
Thank you. Thank you very much.
Thank you for the time. And this is actually the first interview. I'm going to start doing video interviews. So this is like the first one. So I'm so privileged. Yeah. Way to go.
All right.
Okay. Thank you for enduring my unpreparedness and clumsiness. I look forward to the film and can't wait to see it. And congratulations to you and Matthew and everybody involved in this project.
Thank you so much.
Thank you. Have a great day, Kale.
You too. It was nice to meet you.
I'm coming down there, Doctor. I'll be leaving within the hour. I'm flying a civil jet. I want you to meet me.
This is so bogus that I have to work.
What time are you
going to
get here?
Are you bringing Bryce?
About 1,600 hours. And I hope the hell you found him by then.
1,600 hours? So like 5 months from now?
Goodbye.
Should I have said goodbye?
Damn it.
Oscar!
Oscar, of course.
Goodbye.